Hello, welcome back. This is Computer Science 1 Honors, CSCE 155H, and today is our first real lecture of actual material. Remember, I am watching on YouTube for any chat questions. But if you really want, if you have a real question, there's a lot of talk back and forth on YouTube, or there tends to be. So if you do have a question, make sure that you're posting on Piazza. The live Q&A is live. I went ahead and established a new thread for today, and we already had our first question beforehand. An individual wants me to go over Eclipse a little bit more, and don't worry, as we go along, I will do everything in Eclipse. Everything for C, I'll do everything over here in the CS50 IDE. For everything related to Java, of course, I'll be doing it in Eclipse, and then I'll give you some tips and tricks as we go along. Okay. So today we're going to start on the basics of both of these programming languages. But before we do, I wanted to give a little bit of a demonstration of what you experienced in lab yesterday. In particular, when you program, compile, and run a program. Right. So a program starts out as plain text, right? A source file. A source file is a plain text file, right, containing computer code in a particular language. Right? So this is pretty much true for all programming languages. They all start out as plain text. It's not a Word document. It's not rich text with a bunch of accents or symbols and punctuation and special punctuation like the curly double quotes. It's just a plain text file. And so when you edit a source file, you need to use a proper editor. Like I said, you can't use Word. You need to use either an IDE or a plain text editor. Notepad is not a plain text editor. It's not a substitute for a real IDE. Over here, I'm using Eclipse, of course. It has a plain text editor built into it. Over here in CS50, of course, this is a plain text editor. But if you want to, you can watch video 1.3, and I walk you through how to use Atom.io for C programming. Atom.io is what I'm actually using behind the scenes over here to generate these notes. I'm using a language called Markdown. And that's not lag when I type, it's just simply that it needs to re-render. I'm not typing directly on what you're seeing, okay? A source file is then compiled into an executable program, which is, of course, in binary. And that entire process was automatic. When I went over that in Tuesday, and when you went over it in your lab, it was really, really automatic. You just had one command, or you in Eclipse, you just hit a button. What I want to do right now is I want to walk through what's actually going on behind the scenes there. Basically, what's going to happen with at least C, and actually I'm going to be skipping steps here as well, because there's a preprocessor and a bunch of other things and optimization and stuff like that happens. But basically, I'm going to walk you through the basic steps so that you can see what's going on a little bit behind the scenes. When you take a source file, you actually don't compile it directly into machine code. You compile it into assembly code. That assembly code then is translated into machine code. Machine code at the end of the day, again, is just binary. It's a bunch of zeros and ones. So let's go ahead and take a look at that process over here. Here I've got that Hello World program from before. There it is, right? Hello, here it's printing out Hello Chris Burke. And so you, of course, you edit it, you type it. If you've got a syntax error or something like that, then when you try to compile it, the compiler is going to complain, right? That you can't compile that because, well, what is PRI space? I have no idea what that is, the compiler is telling me. So you do have to have correct computer code in here. Any syntax errors and the compiler will simply die and refuse to compile, okay? So let's go ahead and do that first step of taking this high-level C code and translating it into what's called assembly. To do that, I can use the same compiler here, but with a flag. This hyphen and then a letter, those are called flags in Unix programs. Without that flag, it's just the default behavior, right? It compiles in one shot, all at once. But you can provide it flags to change the default behavior. In this case, the S flag is telling it to compile it into assembly, right? And when I do that, you can see that there's this other new file here, hello.s. Let's go ahead and open that up and see what the contents are. And you can kind of see that, well, it's not exactly machine code because it's certainly not binary. It's still somewhat readable. Like we've got this file text, okay, there's a string, hey, there's my hello world message, right? Hello, Chris Burke. But a bunch of other stuff that, unless you know assembly, I don't know what these things are. Basically, they're instructions that are saying, take this thing and put it into the first register. Then take this thing and put it into the second register. Then you can compare those things and those registers and jump to a memory location, right? It's much, much lower level. It's actually speaking machine kind of language here, instead of a high-level programming language that is not quite English. Of course, that would be the ideal. If we could program in English like Star Trek and say, computer do this, computer do that, and it understood us and just went off and did it. That would be a perfect programming language. Unfortunately, we're not there. This is not science fiction. We actually have to write computer programs that then machines actually understand. But at least this is closer to English than this over here, right? And it's certainly going to be, this is still certainly closer to English because we can actually read these words here. And as long as we knew assembly, we'd understand it. Then the machine code that's generated when we actually compile this into machine code. So let's go ahead and do that now. I'm going to go ahead and compile hello.c. That's another flag which tells it to just compile it. Right? That produces this .o file here. You can actually use a utility to ask what these things are. Let's ask what the hello.c file is. And it says that it's a C source file. Right? What about the hello.s file that we assembled before? Well, that's assembler source, right? Well, what about this .o file that we just made? It's an ELF 64-bit LSB relocatable blah, 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 blah. It's an object file, meaning that it is actual computer code, but it's not executable yet. If I tried to execute this, hello.o, right, permission denied. It's not an executable program. It's not something that can actually run yet, and I'll tell you why here in a second. But let's go ahead and take a look at it. It's not even going to let me because it's not a text file, right? If I tried to open it over here, it's probably not even going to let me do that. The format is unsupported. But I can use a utility to look and see what's inside that file called hex dump. And you can see here that it's just a bunch of data. It's a bunch of zeros and ones. Now this is hexadecimal, which is base 16. But of course I can go ahead and use another utility here to actually look at the binary information in that file. And there you can see that it's a bunch of zeros and ones. This first column here are the offsets, the memory offsets. This last column over here is its attempt to interpret those as text. Of course, it's just a bunch of dots because most of them are going to be null bytes, a bunch of zeros, right? So that's what that's taking a high-level computer program in C, assembling it into assembly, and then finally putting it into machine code. But again, this is not runnable. If I tried to run this again, I get the permission denied. What I have to do is I now have to compile this and link it in with the external libraries that I've used. Remember, I didn't start this program from scratch. I brought in a standard library, which has a bunch of stuff in it, and a standard input-output library so that I could actually print something. Without that library, it doesn't know what this printf function is or how it works or anything like that. So I need to do what's called a link in. I've got my hello.o file here, object file, which is machine code now. Somewhere on the system is this input-output library that's been compiled, and it too is binary. I need to link them together to finally produce an executable file. And we did all that in one shot by simply just saying hello.c. Actually, I can go with the .o file here and compile that directly, and I can go ahead and run that now. Hello, Chris Burke. Right? Now, this is not something that you would do on a normal basis. I'm just doing this for presentation purposes so that you know so that you understand that there's a lot going on behind the scene here. In fact, there's a lot more that's going on behind the scene. There's a preprocessor that's changing your code. before it actually compiles. There is an optimization that, again, changes your code and optimizes it, gets rid of dead code, gets rid of changes the structure of your code to an equivalent piece of code so that that it runs faster, that it's more efficient or something like that, okay? So for C, that entire process was, I'll just put it in the notes here, of what we ran through, you can edit a source file, you can assemble it, you can compile it, and it produces an object file, which is just a bunch of machine code that you can't look at directly instead, but you can use a utility to dump the data. Of course, we don't read machine code. Only machines read machine code. We read English, and some of us read assembly language. Some people do program in assembly, but you can kind of see this is some history here too. When computers started out, you did have to write in machine code. You had punch cards and you punched them out for zeros or left them for ones or something like that. So you actually had to do this entire process on a whiteboard or on a piece of paper. And then, if you made a mistake and did a zero instead of a one, then that debugging was nearly impossible. That's why they introduced, that's why they put an abstraction on top of that and introduced assembly code, so you didn't have to speak in zeros and ones. That's why they also introduced more abstract languages like C, and then more abstractions on top of that, Python, where or Java, where you don't have to have direct memory management, which is something that we'll talk about later. Okay. We got another question here. An IDE is an integrated development environment. Okay. And that's what Eclipse is. That is what this is, a browser-based IDE. Of course, there are dozens and dozens of IDEs, even for just Java. You have IntelliJ, you have NetBeans, you have JGrasp, and a bunch of others that that other people use, right? Now, let's look at that same process, but for Java. Now, remember, this is the honors course here, is that we generally cover something in C, and then we cover it again in Java. Java is different than C in that it is not a purely compiled language. It's not, if you ever have ever done Python programming or PHP programming, actually there's no compiling there at all, or JavaScript. Instead, those are interpreted languages, meaning that an interpreter goes through line by line and interprets that and then executes it on the computer, instead of it being translated to machine code first and then it being run. Java is somewhere in between there. Where it's somewhat compiled, it's compiled into what's called Java bytecode. You compile Java code into Java bytecode, right? Which is machine-like language that the Java virtual machine, or JVM, understands. So in other words, we have a machine, a virtual machine, sitting on top of your operating system. A Java bytecode program is not something that your processor, my Mac here, would be able to interpret. Instead, we have a Java virtual machine that sits on top of my Mac OS, and then it runs the programs, right? It may interface down below with the OS, but basically it's another level of abstraction, okay? That's what a JVM is. And there are virtual machines, you might have heard of virtual machines before. For example, your Docker instance right here, that's not a virtual machine, but it's virtualized. I'm maybe off on my terminology there, but basically, it's a virtualization, it's a virtualized environment. That may be delivered by Amazon Web Services here, AWS, and I'm sure that they're running virtual machines on top of virtual servers, on top of virtual whatever, until you actually get down to the actual hardware, the actual wires and gates and stuff like that, okay? The metal is what we call it, right? Bytecode is then interpreted by the JVM. So it's halfway in between there. I'm going to walk you through that. Now this is, I'm going to use the CS50 IDE here to show this to you, this process to you. But otherwise, I'll be using Eclipse. Remember that we compiled using JAVAC, which is the Java compiler. Hello world. And that produces a dot class file here. Let's ask the file utility here, what is that thing? Right. It's compiled Java data version 57, right? I don't know, Java version, which Java version? We have Java 13 here, OpenJDK 13, so we're one version behind. Internally, that corresponds to Java 57. There's kind of a disconnect here. This is the version that most people will, that the consumer sees, and then this is the version that's actually compiled under the hood here. So let's go ahead and take a look at what that looks like. I think I might be able to open it. Okay, no, we're not going to be able to open it up there. So let's go ahead and go with more. Hello.class. All right, there we go. All right. So we see some English there, but we don't. But for the most part, it's all binary and it's not going to be interpreted correctly. We can do a hex dump of the class file, right? And well, again, that's meaningless. But if we let's do xxd of hello world.class and see if it will interpret some of those things as some of it's readable. Like, hey, there's hello Chris Burke, right? Some of it's also some of the other stuff is also readable. For example, java.lang.system, right? Out, right? That's right here, right? That's the output file. That's the output stream. Print stream or println, right? java.lang.string. We've got a lot of English in here because it's halfway between machine code and Java code. It's somewhere in between, and you're able to interpret it using the Java virtual machine, which I did on Tuesday, right? Java hello world, and it goes ahead and executes that compiled Java bytecode. Okay? So that's the basics of what's going on behind the scenes. What I want to do now is I want to look at the anatomy of a program. And to do that, I'm going to go ahead and bring this program over from last year. Let me go ahead and create a new file here. We'll do this in C first. New file, I'll call it foo.c. Your source files for C always end in .c because they're C source files. Your source files for Java files always end in .java. That is just a convention. It doesn't matter. Those are called extensions. And only really Windows really does anything with those extensions, which you might run into problems later on if you try to change the extensions. Windows is going to completely reinterpret what it does with that file. But as long as you're at the command line or with CS50 here, you're going to be fine. I called it foo. You'll see that's really common in computer science. Foo, bar, and baz are basically just placeholders that are used all over the place for examples. There is an example.com or an example whatever, but if you need multiple examples, then these are placeholder words, foo, bar, and baz, that people use all the time just to get some point across. And I'm calling it foo initially here because I wonder what this program does. So let's go ahead and start at the top here. What do you see immediately? This is documentation, right? This is a comment. That's why it's highlighted in blue in my IDE. And I, without even looking at a single line of this program, I can read this sentence right here and says, this program converts miles to kilometers. Awesome. Documentation is great in that it's human readable, it's intended for a human audience, and it will tell you exactly what the purpose of a chunk of code is. That's why you should be including documentation in all of your programs. All right. So let's go ahead and start enumerating these things as we go along. And let me give myself some more room here. There we go. Now it'll always pop to the top. Okay. So the first thing that we saw was a comment. Comments are human readable messages embedded in code. Right? What's their purpose? It's to communicate to another human being what the purpose of the code is. Right? Its purpose or its intention. The why. Why did you write this code? Comments or documentation tell the what and the why. Right? But but not necessarily the how, right? So let's go back over here and look at this example. This program converts miles to kilometers. That's the what. Why did you write this program? Well, because I wanted to be able to convert miles to kilometers. How did you write this program? Well, I'm going to go ahead and look at it line by line. That's the how, right? The how should be self-documenting. A code itself should be self-documenting. That means any reasonably competent person who knows the language should be able to understand how the code works by simply reading the code. Right? Competent person. I'm not competent in my language, my spelling here or typing today. So, of course, I'll go ahead and fix those later on, but fix that one up there. All right, there we go. This code should be self-documenting. So again, let's go ahead and take a look at the example here. I put in additional comments down here. This is another comment. This is another comment there in green because they're single line comments. But if this were a real program, I would not put a comment like this. This is self-evident. Print, please enter miles. Well, clearly I know C, so I know what that's doing. It's prompting the user for input. Read the input. Well, that's scanf. I know C, so I know scanf. Now, eventually, in the next couple of weeks, you'll know what these things are too. And so these comments are completely superfluous. They're unnecessary because this code itself is self-documenting. The only reason I put these comments in here is for demonstration purposes, because we're all beginning here, okay? So in general, code should be self-documenting. The syntax itself that we just saw was that single line comments begin with a double slash, right? Slash, slash, there we go. Now those are forward slashes because if you look at the guy and he's facing to the right, then he is leaning forward. Those are forward slashes. If he's leaning back, those are back slashes. So it's just an easy way of remembering that. Everything after them is ignored by the compiler. In fact, it's not even going to end up in the compiled program for the most part, unless you specify that it should be kept. The compiler is, in fact, maybe even in the preprocessor, is going to go through, look at all the comments, and then just throw them out, right? It doesn't even come into play in the final compiled version of the program, right? Multi-line comments begin with a forward slash star and end with a star forward slash, right? Anything in between is ignored, right? So that you can have multiple lines of comments like I did with my documentation. Doc style comments are just multi-lines comments. Doc style comments are multi-line comments with an additional vertical line of stars or asterisks. We'll call them stars here. Just like I did over here, right? And why? Because now this style is actually quite common. I believe that it started with Java docs, but it's been adopted by a lot of other programs, and it's what I suggest that you get used to and start using. When you at a minimum, your beginning programs are going to be self-documenting. They're going to be simple enough that you don't need this line right here telling you prompt for input. That's not the kind of documentation that we want. We want this kind of documentation. Who's the author? When did they write this? I wrote this a year ago, so let's go ahead and update that. Right? One thing that I saw common was that people did not change the documentation when they handed in their first lab. I didn't write that, you wrote that, so take credit. And then, of course, what the purpose of this program down here. Doc-style comments are very, very useful because they can be parsed and generate actual documentation, web-based documentation, like you would find when you actually search for stuff. Online, that is, all right? Get in the habit of using doc style comments at the top. Get in the habit of using of chunking large pieces of code and then maybe documenting that code if necessary. But again, in general, a code should be self-documenting, okay? All right, what's next in C? All right. So there's our documentation. We've got these includes here. Those are called preprocessor directives, right? So preprocessor directives begin with a hash. That is that hash symbol right there. Or some people call those pound symbols. But of course, now that they're used on Twitter and everywhere else, and they've become popular in the Zeitgeist, then everybody calls them hashes now. By the way, that's very old. It originated in IRC, Internet Relay Chat. It's older than old. It's older than I am. It's nothing new. Just Twitter and other things like Discord, they adopted it because it had been established as having some meanings, right? You can include external libraries with a preprocessor directive with using hash include, right? That's what it means. Include this library in my code, right? For example, we've already had two examples here. We included the standard library and the standard input output library. There's another one that's very, very useful for your upcoming assignments and stuff. It's going to be include math.h, right? So you provide the library name inside Langle Wrangle, right? So that's probably something new there, Langle Wrangle. Well, this is a less than sign. This is a greater than sign. Their interpretation in this context is not mathematical. We're not saying include is less than math.h, that's not what those mean. So we don't call those less than or greater than. We call them left angle bracket and right angle bracket. And we call them, to shorten that up as a portmanteau, we call it Langle Wrangle, right? So you can include the math library. The math library is really, really useful for including things like sine, cosine, a square root function, and a bunch of other things that you would find useful for doing basic math computations. Just like on your calculator. If you look at the buttons on your calculator, there are going to be a lot of equivalencies there in the math library. So that you don't have to reinvent or rewrite a Taylor series to compute the sine function or something like that. Okay? Another example is you can define macros using the define preprocessor directive. And what that means, so you might not be familiar with the term macro, but macro is basically just a recording of a process that can then be repeated. What that is doing right here in the context of this program is I'm defining this. It's actually not a variable, it's actually not a constant. It is an identifier, it's a macro, right? KMS per mile. Now, you can immediately tell, well, that's probably kilometers per mile. Now, you're not paying by the symbol, so you might as well have just written out kilometers per mile, right? In general, you should avoid abbreviations and acronyms and stuff like that, unless the context is absolutely clear. In this case, I think it's absolutely clear because mile, okay, I didn't abbreviate both, right? If I said that, then KMS per M, per meter, per minute, is that a speed? What does that mean, right? But in this context where, miles and kilometers per mile, okay, I understand that now, that's the number of kilometers in a mile, and there's 1.60934 kilometers in a mile, okay? So naming conventions are really important as a stylistic element of your program. You want to make sure that your program is readable. Don't just use random variable names X, Y, or variable 1, variable 2, variable 3, right? Give your variables names of what they stand for. In this case, it's the number of kilometers per mile, right? Now, why would you want to do something like this? Down here, I'm using that identifier here because I'm going to read in the miles from the user, convert that over to kilometers by doing kilometers per mile times the number of miles that they rode or that they want to convert, right? And the reason that I'm using that up here instead of just, well, I could have just used this number down here instead, right? But now think about this in, from two perspectives. One perspective is, if you just jumped into this program, what does that number stand for? Now, you might know off the top of your head, well, I know that there are 1.60934 miles or kilometers per mile, right? Not a lot of us do. Some numbers do lend themselves to immediate identification. If I write 3.14, I probably mean pi. If I write 2.71, I probably mean e, right? If I write zero, of course, I mean nothing, right? Mysterious numbers like these that have no name and force me to think about the larger context are not good practice. Instead, use an identifier, KMS per mile. That's readable. I don't even have to think about, well, how many kilometers per are there per mile, right? I can just understand that that's a value that I can use, right? So macros are useful because macros eliminate the need for what are called magic numbers. I call it a mysterious number, but these are actually called magic numbers. Numbers whose purpose or value is not immediately apparent. Right? So that you don't have this this code where you just have a bunch of seemingly random numbers everywhere. You want your code to be readable, right? Macros also allow you to store to represent a single value in a single place. And what I mean by that is, now this is a pretty simple program. I only used KMS per mile in one spot. Imagine that I had a very, very complex program, a program where I used this 1.60934 number over and over again, and in 50 different functions and 50 different libraries, right? Well, what if I wanted to make it more accurate? Right? In fact, if we ask Wolfram Alpha over here, how many kilometers are there? 1 mile to kilometer. You could actually make this a little bit more accurate. Oh, come on, more digits. They're not going to tell me. All right. Well, there should be another 4 over there. I want to make this accurate by making it another 4. So it's actually 1.609344. Now, imagine that that number was in 50 different locations. I'd have to go and make 50 different changes. Whereas because I've collected it here in one macro, that means that I only have to make one change. And it's changed everywhere I reference that thing. So it means that you can represent a value in a single place, right? Sometimes these are called constants, right? Because they're not variable. You cannot vary the number unless you bend space-time or something like that. You cannot vary the number of miles per kilometer. And even if you did, then you're still bending, it's just a scale, right? All right, so. Macros make your code more readable and maintainable. Right. So there we go. That's good. What's next? We have our main here. For now, don't worry about these things. Right? We'll talk about those later. Those are command line arguments, and that's what arg is short for. This is argc, argument count, the number of arguments. This is argv, that's an arg vector, the actual vector or the list of arguments, or in this case, it's an array of arguments, all right? But the main program is your main entry point. Every program, or every executable program, has a main entry point, right? Usually a main function, or in Java, a main method. And we'll talk about that here in a second when we go over all this again with Java. Otherwise, you have linear flow of control flow. Right? A program begins executing, starting at the main, and goes, in general, it goes top to bottom. Right? If I've got command after command after command, I declare a bunch of variables, then I prompt the user for the input. I read the input, I convert the input, and then I print out the output, right? It does that in a top to bottom manner. It does this command, then this command, then this command, then this command. That's called a linear control flow, right? It's not going to, it would be very, very confusing if our the lines of code were randomly executed without without respect for the order in which they were written, okay? All right, other syntax and punctuation. I really like to compare writing a program to actually writing English, because that's what the whole point of introducing high-level programming languages is in order to make communicating and telling a computer what to do closer and as close as possible to plain old English, right? For that reason, computer programming languages have adopted a lot of what we use in daily in our actual written languages, right? Commas delimit lists, right? Lists of arguments. Where did we see that in our program up here? I'm creating two variables. Well, how do you say that this is, there's a miles variable and there's a KMS variable? You put a comma between them. I've got arguments that are given to this function. How do you say there's one argument, here's another argument? You delimit it with a comma. Comma, comma, comma everywhere. Comma here, right? That is delimiting a list. And unlike English, where you can go, I want cake, comma, ice cream, comma, and fudge, right? Well, that last comma there is the Oxford comma. Is it necessary? I don't know. It depends on your opinion on the Oxford comma. There's no Oxford comma in programming, right? There are hard and fast rules as to when you need to use a comma or other punctuation. Semicolons end each executable statement. Note here, I'm talking about executable statement. There are some statements here that are not executable. For example, including a library, or this preprocessor directive defining the kilometers per mile. That's not an executable. It's literally a cut and paste. What happens here is that the preprocessor goes through and says, all right, anytime that I see this KMS per mile, I'm going to do a cut and paste operation. And I will take this value and I will replace it and or replace that value, and then I'm going to go compile it. Okay, so it's not an executable statement. It's something that is a directive to something else. These are certainly executable statements. This is declare these two variables, miles and kilometers, which are going to be doubles, and we'll talk about that momentarily. Print this message to the user. Read from the user some value and place it into this this variable right here. Take this value and multiply it by this value and place that value over here, right? These are executable statements and they all end with semicolons. It's like the end of a sentence. If you have a sentence, period, another sentence, period, another sentence, period. We have periods in order to delimit each sentence. Well, in programming languages, we have semicolons that end each executable statement, okay? Curly brackets denote the beginning end of a code block, right? A block of code is kind of like a paragraph. So if we've got sentence, 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 and we put them all together and we indent and then indent to the next paragraph, that chunk is a paragraph. That's all related to each other. Over here, we use an opening curly bracket and a closing curly bracket in order to group all of this code together into one block. That block is all part of the main function in this case. You can have blocks of code that are inside of other blocks of code. That's called nesting. And with this simple program, though, it's not necessary. But the curly brackets here denote a code block. Some programming languages don't use that. If you've ever had Python experience, they simply use indentation. Okay. Speaking of indentation, in general, white space does not matter for the language itself. Right? The times that it does matter are, well, you do have to separate these things out, right? Otherwise, they'd be all be this. There. That's only one thing, one token, as we call those. But otherwise, the space there doesn't matter. Right? The space here doesn't matter. In fact, I could go ahead and getting rid of the comments, I could go ahead and put all of these lines of code onto one line with no regard for any spacing whatsoever. And you can see immediately that that is not going to be readable at all, right? The reason that we put in white space is for humans, and so that your code is human readable. Let me undo all that. There we go. So white space is your friend, right? White space generally, definitely matters to humans. It makes your code more readable and thus maintainable. It's something to realize that when you write code, when you're a developer, it takes much more time and effort to read and understand code than it does to actually write code. The code that you wrote a year ago that you forgot about it, if it wasn't well written, if it had poor styling, you look at it a year later, what the heck did I write? It's not going to be readable at all. So keep that in mind. Good style is absolutely necessary for readable programs, right? Style above all should be consistent. Right. So for example, right? Blocks of code should all be indented at the same level. And that's what I did over here. Imagine if I said, okay, I'll go ahead and indent this, but I'll indent it using four spaces. Here I'll go ahead and use two tabs instead. I don't want to indent for that one. And for this one, I'll go ahead and use three spaces just because it's weird, right? Here I'll just do one space, right? Now it's all over the place. This is kind of like writing a list in an outline, right? Bullet point, bullet point, bullet point, like I'm doing in the notes here. The notes are nicely well organized. Indent, all of these bullet points are at the same level, as same indentation level, meaning that they are all related to each other, right? If this is all over the place, in fact, there's no way you can even force this to become all over the place because this is markdown. But if I were writing an outline and the indentation was all over the place, you would certainly be downgraded on that in an English class. You'll certainly be downgraded on that in a computer science class. Write readable, maintainable code, okay? Sorry, there's a class going on in here right now. Never mind. All right. There are also reserved words. Reserved words include, say, int, double, and return, right? Among others. I'm only highlighting a few of them here. For example, double over here, int over here, wonder what those are. We're going to talk about variables and variable types here in a second. But otherwise, there are some reserved words that by the language that have a special meaning in the language itself, okay? That you should not use and that you're, in fact, you should only use them in the context that they are intended for, all right? All right, so let's do all that over again, but let's look at it with respect to Java. Sorry about that, some interlopers here. Okay, so in Java, let's go ahead and I'm going to cut and paste the exact same program over here, but I'll do it over in Eclipse. Now I'm going to go ahead and create a new class, miles 2 kilometers. And finish that, and it creates this new class here, public class miles to kilometers. There's also a miles to kilometers.java file here. So in Java, the first rule is that whatever your class name is, it has to the file name has to have the same name .java, and that's just a rule of Java. It's a requirement, right? So we immediately see, I haven't finished this program. In fact, we'll just go ahead and write this as we go along. I have not finished this program yet. So let's go ahead and look at the parallels between our C program over here and this Java program. Well, first of all, I don't have any comments, documentation or comments over here. Let's go ahead and bring those over. Doc style comments are usually attached to the blocks of code that they're documenting. After this package declaration up here. But what the heck is this? That's exactly, package declaration up here is an organization. We talked about this briefly on Tuesday, that it's in this package, unl.cse. That simply means that you're organizing stuff into folders. In fact, since people asked about IDE tips and tricks here, I'm going to go ahead and right click on this, go to the properties, and this is where it's being stored on my disk here, user cburk workspace hello. You can click on this button here to actually jump to that workspace. And where's my hello? There it is. And let's look at the source file. You'll see that there's a UNL folder. Under that, you see a CSE folder. And under that, finally, you see the two files that are showing up in my IDE, my Eclipse over here, right? There they are. So a package declaration is simply just a way of organizing code, okay? Let's go ahead and get rid of this. There we go. All right. So let's actually write this program by translating everything over. Now there is a standard input-output library, and there's a standard library as far as Java is concerned, but they are automatically brought in. If I did need to import a particular library, I could say import java.math, I think. Yep. There it is. java.lang.math, but it's already being imported automatically. In fact, that's what this yellow warning here is, that in fact, let's read the message here. Import is never used. Well, that's a different message, but anything in the java.lang package is automatically imported into your Java program. So we don't need this, but if we needed something else, say for reading input, import java.util.scanner. There we go. We are going to use this later on. The scanner is how I'm going to actually read input from the user as they type it in, okay? And that is in java.util. It's a utility class, okay? But that looks exactly like something like over here, right? So instead of including things, we're importing them into Java. And many other languages like have includes or imports or whatever, right? Whatever their keyword is that they use for that stuff. What else did we do in this program? Well, we created first of all, we had the main entry point here, right? So we'll do that in Java using a public static void main, string args. Again, don't worry about those arguments yet. We'll talk about command line arguments later. Public static void, don't worry about those. If you want a preview of this, public just simply means that anybody can see this code. Any other code outside of this class can access this code. Static means that the method itself belongs to the class instead of an instance to the class. We'll talk about object-oriented programming towards the end of the semester. Void is the return value of this main function over here. Over here, the return value was an integer. You could make this an integer, and it'd be perfectly fine in Java. For now, I'm going to go ahead and keep it as void. Void means nothing. It doesn't return anything, okay? Now, what did we do next? We created two variables. Well, how do we translate that into Java? We don't have to, right? It's automatic, right? It's the exact same syntax in both languages to create double variables, and we'll talk about doubles later on, right? Now, what do I need to do? I need to prompt the user to enter some input, right? All right. System.out.println, please enter miles. All right, there we go. End the line with a semicolon. Rather large, there we go. That's a little bit better. It doesn't need to be that big. And there's our prompt there. Instead of, you can use printf, by the way, but the difference between ln and f is that it does not print that end line character. So if you want the print line, the end line character printed for you, you can use ln. But if you want to handle that on your own, you can use printf. Right? System.out is the standard output. Right? When printf is used, implicitly it's the standard output. What's the standard output? It's down here in the terminal. Okay. All right. What do we do next? We need to read in the input. And for that, I need to create what's called a scanner in Java. So scanner s is equal to a new scanner of system.in. Right? Now, I'll walk you through. A scanner is something that scans input, or it scans a file, or it scans something. In this particular case, I'm telling this scanner to scan the system input. System.out is the standard output, so system.in is the standard input. So when somebody sits there and mashes on the keyboard, that's the standard input. The keyboard is the standard input. This terminal down here is going to be the standard output. Once I've got that, I can then read in the miles. Instead of using scanf, I will ask s dot, or miles is equal to s dot next double. Now what this is going to do is the program is going to sit there and wait until somebody types in the input and hits enter, at which point it'll try to read what the person entered and then put that value into miles. All right. So let's go ahead. What about this other one over here? KMS per kilometers is equal to KMS per mile. Let's go ahead and translate that. The only problem here is that we don't have KMS per mile at all. All right. I kind of skipped over that. Let's do that now. There is no preprocessor in Java, so there are no preprocessor directives. But we can get kind of the same behavior if we create a public static final double KMS per mile is equal to 1.609344. I'll just make it more accurate immediately. Okay. Public static. What does mean? It just means that everybody can see it. Static means it belongs to the class. Final is Java's way of making something final, meaning that you cannot change the value. Say down here, if I wanted to change the value to 2, right, it's not going to let me. It shouldn't let me. Oh, it's choking because of down here. So we'll make it not choke down there. Now it's choking up here. If you read this, remove the final modifier. So the final field KMS per mile cannot be assigned. Why? Because it's final. Once you set it, that's it. It's final. You can never change it, which is a very, very good thing. Up there in the math library, math.py, there's this value for pi, 3.14159 dot 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 dot. Imagine if we were able to change that to just 3. Right? No, you can't do that. Why? Because the final field cannot be assigned. Those are called constants. These are variables because you can change their values like we do down here. This ends up using the final keyword means that it ends up being a constant. Okay. Otherwise, we've got that. Now we just simply need to print out the output. For that, I'm going to use system.out.println percent. Or no, I'm going to use miles. Plus miles is blank KMS. Kilometers. There we go. And then the program ends. Somebody did ask on Thursday, do you need a return statement? You don't absolutely need one, but it is good practice to put one there. Even though you're not returning anything, it's a void function. Let's go ahead and run this and see what it looks like. Please enter miles. You'll note down here that the stop sign is still here, or the stop button is still here, because now the program is still running. It's prompting me for input. It has halted. It has said, I'm going to wait for you to mash your keyboard and give me something that I can process. Let's just say 100 miles, okay? 100 miles is 160.9344 kilometers. Easy enough, right? And you can see here that the program is now terminated because it was waiting for my input. When I typed something in and hit enter, then it took over again. It woke up and said, okay, now I'll read what you gave me. I wonder what happens if we give it something bad. 10? What is 10 kilometers? Well, it's 10 miles. Well, it's 16 kilometers, right? An exception, right? What happened? Input mismatch exception. This is what happens in Java when you give it bad input or when something bad happens, an exception occurs. I wonder what happens over here with this version of the program. So let's go ahead and compile this foo program. Oops. Undeclared identifier. Define it up there. I must have misspelled it. I said miles up here. And I said mile down here. So there we go. All right. Thank you, compiler. You can clear that out. Remember, here's a tip that you can go ahead and hit the up button to do a previous command so you don't have to retype it all. Please enter miles, 100 miles. And that's exactly the same input output as we got with our Java program. What happens here if we mash the keyboard though? It's 10, right? 0 and 0, something different happens. And that's because of the way scanf works here. Scanf is looking at my input, TEN. It's looking for a floating point number or just a number. Well, it sees the letter T, and it says, okay, I must be done parsing. I can't parse anymore. I can't interpret the input anymore. What have I parsed so far? Well, I've parsed nothing. What's the numerical value of nothing? 0. And that's why 0 times what KMS per mile ends up being 0 over here, okay? But you can see that there is almost a direct translation from this very simple program in C to a very simple program in Java. More complex programs, of course, you would not be able to do this with, but you can see that, you know, 60, 70, 80% of the programming structure is the same in both programming languages. And that's why when you learn one programming language, you should be able to pick up another programming language pretty quickly, because once you learn know the basic concepts, well, I've got strings, I've got numbers, I can manipulate numbers, I can manipulate values. How do I do this in this programming language? And it all pretty much ends up being the same. Which begs the question, why do we have so many programming languages? Because we have so many opinions. I don't like the way that C does this. I don't like the way that that language does that. I don't like the way that this language does this, right? And so I'm gonna go ahead and make my own programming language. And if somebody goes off, makes a programming language. It's like the XKCD, XKCD standards. There we go. Of course, this is very famous. There are 14 competing standards. There are 100 programming languages. Why can't we just have one perfect programming language? Ridiculous. We need to develop one universal standard that covers everybody's cases or satisfies everybody's opinions. Guess what? Now there are 15 standards, or 101 programming languages now, right? It's because people have opinions on how things should work or how things should go. There are lots of programming languages because there are lots of programming language styles or paradigms, and you'll see. And so we're stuck with there is no universal programming language, right? Even if we had natural language programming where we could use English, we would still just be in the same boat now. Well, I want to use Chinese. Well, I want to use Spanish. I want to use whatever, right? We have a lot of programming languages because we're people, we're humans, right? All right, I don't see any questions online. So let's go ahead and start talking a little bit more about, actually, I'm going to port over these notes and revise what we were talking about. So Java organizes code based in packages, which is a tree organized structure. It's a hierarchy. It's just a directory structure, basically. Each one is separated by a period and corresponds to actual directories on the file system. Doing this allows you to organize your code into different directories and subdirectories so that you can put all the math stuff over here and all the physics stuff over there or whatever. Right? You do the same thing in C, by the way. It's just that you do it in a different way. You organize them into different header and source files. We'll talk about that later on, though. All source files must have the same root name as the class. For example, miles to kilometers must be in a source file that is miles to kilometers.java, which will definitely compile to a .class file called miles to kilometers.class. To bring in external classes, you can use the import keyword and specify the class and the package name and the class name that you want to bring in. Here's another example, java.lang.math. That's not necessary because anything in the java.lang package is automatically brought in by the language itself. Well, once you have that, you can call methods, call functions and use those functions, say in the math library, .squareRoot. Right? The main entry point is still the main entry point in the Java program. You can write classes that don't have a main. It's just that those are not executable classes anymore. Those are library classes instead, if you want to call them that. Comments are exactly the same as in C. Variables are also extremely similar. Right? So, in fact, the three variables that we're going to focus on are all going to be exactly the same. Right? Java and C are what are called statically typed languages, right? Don't worry about the details of what that means. Worry about the practical concerns for what it means. It simply means that variables and their types must be declared before they can be used, right? When you declare a variable, you specify its name or identifier and its type, right? That is the type of value it can hold, right? Optionally, you can also assign a value to the variable when you declare it. You can declare multiple variables like you saw in our example program using a comma. Of course, they all have to be the same type. You can, you delimit them all by a comma. And you need to provide a name, a different name, a unique name. You can't have two variables named A in the same context, in the same scope. We'll talk about the scope later here. But let's look at the basic types for both C and Java. We're only going to focus on three of them. First of all, an integer, right? Both languages have support for an integer. This is a 32-bit signed 2's complement integer. Don't worry about that, right? Just understand that it has limitations. It can represent whole numbers, negative, zero, and positive, right? In the range, right? This is its limitation. In the range, negative. I'm just going to cut and paste this because I don't want to retype all that. In the range of negative 2,174,483,648 to up to positive 2,100 blah 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 47, right? It's a 2's complement, a 32-bit 2's complement integer. If you want to know how that actually works under the hood, one of those bits is for the sign bit. It's for 0 for positive, 1 for negative. That leaves 31 bits of representation that you can use. Since bits are 0 or 1, that means that you can represent a value of 2 to the 31st. But on one end, we have minus 1 because, well, we start at 0. 0, 1, 2, 3, all the way up, means that we can only represent one short of 2 to the 31st. On the other end, we using this 2's complement representation, we don't need to start at 0 because we already have a representation for 0. So we can go all the way to negative 2 to the 31st. Right? So there are limitations to an integer. There's a maximum and a minimum value that you can represent, but any whole number in that entire range is representable by a 32-bit integer in both languages. So what happens if you need a number that's larger than that? Okay, well, there is support for longs. They call them long integers. And they're 64 bits. Well, what happens if you need to represent something even larger? Well, there's a long in C, but not in Java. And that's 128 bits typically. Okay, well, what if you need to represent something even bigger? Now, at that point, you're bringing in a library, a multi-precision library, because the larger and larger you make them, computers are finite objects, meaning that they can only represent a finite amount of stuff. They can't represent infinity. Even so, there's some numbers that they can't represent at all. 1/3, 0.333333, that goes on forever, for infinity. You only have a limited number of bits. You only have a limited amount of memory to represent this stuff, so it's got to stop sometime. So you're going to represent it as 0.333333333, and then either, you know, then it stops, or it goes down to 2, or it goes up to 4 or something, depending on how you're representing it. It's not going to be exact. Everything in a computer is finite. Everything is discrete. That's it with discrete, not the other kind of discrete, right? If you need more precision, or if you need more significant figures than sig figs, then you need to use a library to do it, right? Both languages support a double, right? This is a 64-bit floating point number. Right? Don't worry about the range here. The range is actually much larger, but the limitation here is the number of digits of accuracy. It has 16, about roughly 16 digits of accuracy, meaning that you can accuracy. It's basically using scientific notation. In fact, that's exactly what it's doing. It's just doing it in a different base. You can take a number and shift it, so normalize it, so it's between 0 and 9. And then, of course, you would have an exponent over here, however much you shifted it, that represents that shift in base 10. Same exact thing in a computer, except that it's base 2, binary. This is called the mantissa. This is called the exponent, and you have a sign bit over here. That mantissa only has enough bits to represent about 16 decimals of accuracy. It's not 16 bits, it's more bits than that. But the implication, the consequence of this is that you can only have 16 digits of accuracy. You can have a very, very big number because you can make that exponent very, very big. 2 to the 300 or something, right? So that's a huge number, but only the 16 most significant digits are representable in that number. Any lower order digits are not representable at all. Right? So understand that there are limitations to all the numbers that you can use. Right? The third one that we're going to look at is a char, which is a single character variable. Right? It's a variable that can hold one character, C, or an H, or an R, or an I, or an S. It can't represent my entire name, Chris. Right? Instead, you would need to use a string, and we'll talk about those later. All right? But a character. No question. See. Yeah, very, very bad style there to do. What's that called? Alt caps, alternating cap styles, or SpongeBob feet. Actually, I think that's one of your. I could be wrong, but I've assigned that before of writing a program to convert a bunch of text into SpongeBob speak, you know, the alt cap speak. All right, that was just a comment on YouTube if somebody gave. All right, so a little bit of a distraction here. So in C, what a character is a single ASCII text character. What is an ASCII text character? For that, I'm going to pull up the ASCII text table. Well, it's immediately available up here, but let's look at another website here. There we go, ASCIICode.com. No, I don't want this one. This one. There we go. Zoom out there. So every single letter in the English alphabet is represented by some number. For example, a capital A is represented by the number 64. A lowercase a is represented by the number 97. Right? You'll see that the ASCII text table, ASCII stands for American Standard Code for Information Exchange, it dates back to the 1950s, and it's pretty apparent that it dates back to the 1950s because if you look at a lot of these control statements over here, they come from typewriters. In fact, there's a vertical tab, right? Because you can take the drum of a typewriter and go down. There's a carriage return, which is again from a typewriter. There's a difference between going in the middle of the drum, you push the drum up and go down to the next line, but in the same column, versus you're typing, and then the drum gets to the end and goes ding, and then you have to push it back, right? It's all inspired by the teletype and the typewriters of old, right? But the standard was built in established in the 1950s because of the advent of the electronic computers, right? And it was designed with the thought in mind that everything should be naturally ordered, A, B, C, D, right? The alphabetic ordering, but all capital letters come before all lowercase numbers. So it is not like a dictionary ordering. The dictionary would put all A's, regardless of capitalization or lowercase, together, right? Apple and Alexander would be close, not absolutely together, but they would be in the A section. If the dictionary were ordered by all caps first, then it would have A through Z all caps, and then A through Z all lowercase, right? So that's this is not dictionary ordering. This is something called lexicographic ordering. And of course, the digits, the single character representations of the digits are in order, but things like spaces or punctuation come before any of that stuff. So it's a very well-organized table with a lot of little tricks that you can just flip a single bit to, say, convert a capital into a lowercase or vice versa. It was well thought out and well designed for the time, but of course, we don't live in the 1950s anymore. But it's still a thing. We have a lot of new text, right? Emojis, and you can have a smiley face with or without sunglasses, or poop emojis, or something like that. And so a need for additional representation of characters has always been a thing. In fact, even after this ASCII text table was established, they extended the ASCII text code from 0 up to 127. They just continued 128 up to 255. Why? Because, well, we need umlauts now, right? these pictorial kind of characters over here. Well, more and more of the world started using computers. Now we need to represent Chinese, Japanese, and Korean fonts. We need to now represent ancient Egyptian hieroglyphics, right? And so our character sets have been expanding. Right now we call it Unicode. And there's an expansion enough for several millions of different characters. Only a small percentage, I think 10 or 20%, have been defined so far. So we have plenty of room to expand if you want to create new languages with new symbols. Unfortunately, they only allow actual languages. Somebody tried to get Unicode characters for Klingon, and I think that they were denied with the reason being that it's not a real language, right? So, in C, it's only a single ASCII text character. But in Java, you can do anything you want because it has full Unicode support, right? In Java, it's a full Unicode character, so you could have that poop emoji as a variable name if you really wanted to. Don't do that. But certainly you could have a poop emoji print to the output. I don't think I'm set up to do it right now, but let's see, it was smiley. Smile with sunglasses there. The emoji. All right. Heart eyes instead. I wonder what happens if I put it over here. Yeah, it'll show up over here in Markdown. Let's try it over here. I'll go ahead and system.out.println. There we go. I don't think that this is going to work, but we'll find out. I don't think this is going to work because I don't know that my console supports Unicode. Certainly, Java code supports it. You can put in whatever characters you want into Java code. Oh, okay. I am set up for emojis. Oh, wow. Not something I would do, though. let's try another thing. Let's try, instead of miles, let's go ahead and, you can do that in some Java, if you're set up to do that in your Java code, you can have variable names that are Unicode. Don't do that though, right? And I'm not set up to do it. Okay. All right, with our last 2 minutes here, any questions so far? Otherwise, once you have variables, you have operators, right? The first operator that we're going to look at when we come back on Tuesday is the assignment operator, which is the single equal sign. Allows you to assign values, assign and reassign to variables. And we were implicitly using it all over the place. So, no questions? Let's see how many people are joining us today. Only 12, so that's half of the class, at least. It's okay if you want to watch this later on. If you just want to watch it after the fact or something like that, or in the beginning, if you do have a lot of experience already, or at least some experience, the simple stuff of variables and operators you might be familiar with it already, and that's fine. But again, remember that we're starting with zero assumption of knowledge. So if this is all new to you, great. You're learning a lot then. All right. I will see you on Tuesday. Do keep in mind starting next week, we have face-to-face. And for the 8th section, there is plenty of room in this room if everybody wants to come face-to-face for lecture, certainly for lab. We have an overflow room and we're able to accommodate everybody. So I might see you on Tuesday. Otherwise, I will be continuing to broadcast. So if you do choose to come, understand that I am going to still continue with the live broadcast on YouTube. It's just that you'll be able to ask questions. So understand that you might end up being recorded, at least your audio recorded. Okay? All right. Then have a great weekend.